who of you is using Elasticsearch? Okay. And who of you is using InfluxDB? Okay. I did not scare you away. Right? When you heard InfluxDB, it was like, oh. What I'm going to talk today about is a tool that we wrote at Trivago. And it's not only about the tool, it's also more about your development process and why it's useful to have those simple tools. So the tool is called Protector, and it's a circuit breaker for time series databases. And I will explain to you what that means. First of all, I'm Matthias. I'm work at Trivago. I'm part of the backend team. Care about website performance. And we do have a monitoring stack, and it's based on Elasticsearch and also based on InfluxDB. And that works all pretty fine. But there were some issues, let's say, with the latter part, which boils down to, not having a circuit breaker. But first of all, I want to explain to you what is a circuit breaker and what is a time series database. I guess I start with the more common part, so time series database. I guess most of you already heard of what that is, so I will make that quick. It's just a sequence of data points, and it's measured on a fixed interval. So it could be, for example, CPU usage, it could be memory usage, it could be logins per interval on your main website, could be the server response time, things like that. Everything that you can express as a number and everything that you can measure on a regular basis, let's say every 10 seconds or so. And you have a format like this, where you say you have an identifier, whatever that looks like. There's different implementations of that. So this is the graphite normal structure. So it's a kind of a namespace. So SFO would be then maybe your data center, and then you have all the web servers, and then you have server one. And for that, you measure the memory, and there you measure the memory usage. And this name will always stay the same. So this is one fixed metric. And you calculate the current memory usage on a 10-second interval. For example, here you have, for this Unix timestamp, you generate, for example, 220 megabytes of RAM used. And then in the next 10 seconds, it goes down to 212, and so on and so on. And you do that over and over again. And then you get graphs. And this is how the monitoring works. So there's a lot of systems in that area. Most popular ones, I would say, are Splunk, maybe. But Splunk is very expensive. It costs like a Ferrari per month if you have a lot of data. So that's why there's a lot of open source implementations. Example is Druid and Prometheus, which is this one. And InfluxDB. And the cool thing about InfluxDB is that it is kind of compatible with the old Graphite. And Graphite was a Python tool that was written a long time ago, at least in IT times. And it's very nice if you switch from an old legacy system like Graphite to a new system like InfluxDB. Because you don't lose any data, and you can graph it all with the same tools and so on. So this is very nice, and this is also why we use it at Trivago. We use this since the very early beginnings. We played around with it since, let's say, in the beta versions even. And that worked pretty well. So round about some numbers of what we do. 120 million unique visitors per month, 55 platforms by now, 100 million requests per per day. So that would be 850 megabits per second average traffic, and that doubles every year. So I'm not 100% sure if these are the current numbers, but they are close to current. But That grows very fast, but I guess everybody working in that kind of area knows that it's just a humongous amount of data that you can monitor, and that's why a log can go wrong, and you should better do some monitoring. The thing is, you want a solution that is efficient. You don't want a whole team around that. You just want to get it up, get it running, and forget about it. But it's not that easy, because there's new requirements coming in every day. You have new services you want to monitor all the time. So these are the constraints. And this is where InfluxDB was really shining for us. So it's a newly developed time series database, started in 2012. It's a very high performance. It's just a key value store, nothing else. And additionally to that, a query language on top of it, where you can query the data again. It's written in Go. It has built-in cluster support, which means you can scale up to many machines. I will go into that a little bit later on. It's compatible with Graphite, as I said, and yeah, they get funding. So it's not only an open source project that can go, let's say, out of scope in the next couple months or so. So it's more of an ongoing type of thing. So they try to build an ecosystem around InfluxDB now. There's a dashboard solution, and let's say there's an alerting solution, and things like that. But the core part is open source. And that's the only thing that we use. So we only use the InfluxDB itself and not the whole infrastructure. Because it makes no sense for us, because we have other tools that, in our opinion, for our use case, do it better. So how do we really use it then? We have 3 million different metrics that we collect for 500 servers roundabout, but this grows. We don't monitor all the servers with InfluxDB, so we try to scale it up over time. We have around about 1 terabyte of metric data per month that we persist, so that we keep. The rest is more temporary. But of course, you can monitor a lot more. What is the output of that thing? We have around about 150 engineers, and every one of them is running queries. So we get around about 100K queries per day, something like this. So with this 100,000 queries per day, most of them are through dashboards. Some of them are through manual querying. So if you directly go to the InfluxDB administration and type something in, that would be a manual query then. Or if you go to your dashboard solution, which could be Grafana, for example, if you type something in there manually, then this is a manual query. But most of the stuff is automated through dashboards. If this runs fine, then it looks a bit like this. So that's the normal operation. And you can immediately see there's something strange going on here. Some explanation for that. For monitoring our servers, we use a small daemon called CollectD. And it's written in C. It runs on your server all the time. And it's very, very lightweight. And it has a lot of plugins, so over 100 plugins. So you can basically monitor anything out of the box. And if there's something missing, then you can add your own monitoring solutions, like writing a little Go script that outputs those metrics, or writing a Bash script or Python or what have you. Whatever you want, you can monitor there. And those daemons, they aggregate the data on each server. And then they send it off in batches to InfluxDB, which makes a lot of sense, because over 10 seconds, for example, a lot might change in your in your values for your application. Let's say you measure the number of logins on your website, and you say in that 10-second interval, in the beginning you have let's say 5 logins in the first second, and then you have 5 again. So it will aggregate all of those in the 10-second batch, for example, and then summed it up and only sent the sum, so the final result, to InfluxDB. And this way you can avoid a lot of traffic over the net, over the wire. That's why we use it. And usually, if there's no problems, it runs very well. But if there's problems, then the queue on the server side, so where we collect the metrics, the queue for collect D, it will just grow and grow and grow because it cannot send data to InfluxDB. There's, let's say, a connection issue. You cannot send the data anymore, so it needs to persist it somewhere. It's storing it either in memory or on disk, and just it keeps up, keeps piling up. And what happens then in this moment here is that suddenly InfluxDB is available, for example, again. And it can now ingest all this data that has aggregated over a long time span. And it can get it from the client again. And this is where all the metrics that are currently in the batch are sent to InfluxDB again. So you see a little peak here, which says, OK, suddenly a nice little traffic peak. And then everything is smooth again. You don't have that much traffic anymore. You can also see, maybe if you look very closely, this here is a little peaky sometimes. So it's, I'm lacking the English term for it, but a little rippy, you know? And then there comes the little peak, and then it's pretty smooth. So that's a clean line. And what we've discovered is that those little peaks here, they are very bad. So there might be a garbage collector running on InfluxDB that causes this, or there's a flaky network connection, something like this. Usually this boils down to InfluxDB being very, very busy and doing aggregations in the background. That is also something that InfluxDB does for you. Once it has a lot of data, it's compressing this in batches as well. So let's say after a day or so, you have one day of data, and it will load it again from disk, compress it, and then store the compressed version, and not all of the data. So otherwise, it would be an enormous amount. But right now, InfluxDB can compress the data so much that you have, for one data point, I guess you need 1 bit or so right now. You might think, OK, how is this possible, 1 bit? Usually, you do it in bytes. No, it's really a bit. So because the compression, what they found is the numbers don't change that often. And you can only store, let's say, the diff and say, do some kind of Huffman encoding. But yeah, pretty effective in this one. So this is, I would say, normal operations. This is not what you need a circuit breaker for, because here there is a problem, let's say, with just you need to scale it up to another instance, for example, because it's super busy. But it's working as it's supposed to be working. But what you need a circuit breaker for are things when the user fires a query, and this can be potentially very, very expensive. And you cannot really block that in InfluxDB. It will be executed. Every query will be executed. So look at those query examples. This is coming from InfluxDB itself, and this is the query language that it's using. So in the first one, you have select star from my series. So that would mean give me all the data points from this series. The second one is then a select star from series where time bigger now minus 24 hours. So give me the last 24 hours. And then the third one is group by time 1 hour. That would mean give me what you have, but group it into 1 hour values. So let's say you have for each minute, you have a data point, so 60 data points per hour. It would aggregate that into one data point and would send it to you, saying, OK, this was for the grouping for 1 hour. And you would get all of the data, but in groups of 1 hour, if you say group by time 1 hour. Or you say, give me the last 10 values. Or you can combine those, like give me the last 24 hours, and group it by 1 hour, so that would be 24 data points then. Make sense? Yeah? You can specify the aggregation as well. So this is not with aggregation. You can specify, for example, select median and then star. So star would be all the fields. There's more than one field. But in general, you want to aggregate, let's say, over the value. You can say select median and then parentheses, value parentheses. And you would get the median over the current values. Yeah. But if you do only select star, then you will get just the data points that were stored. No aggregation whatsoever. Yeah. But we at Trivago, we always use median and percentiles. So median for normal operations. And then on top of that, in your graphs, you have, let's say, 95 percentile to see the scope of values that you have. So the variation, let's say. There was a question, no?
Yeah, sorry.
So grouping gives you, it's a form of aggregation, you're correct, you're right. So for the last 60 minutes, it will give you one data point. That's also one form of aggregation, yeah? I guess it will always take the last one, but in that case, so it's kind of an aggregation sort of thing, but still, there you can group, and then it will aggregate on the server side, but also you can say give a custom aggregation function like a median, and then it will apply to this result that you calculated, it will apply the median and send you the median values for it. Very flexible, very powerful, very dangerous. What is the most dangerous query here? Yeah. This would mean give me all the data for this series. And if you run this for a year or so, that's a lot of data points if you think of it. So it needs to go to disk, it needs to load every shard, it needs to query, you need to find out if there's any data that you want inside that shard. It needs to extract the data from that shard. It needs to aggregate that on the server side, and it will die. And this can happen pretty fast. This looks like this, then. If you run this query, then for sure this will happen. And that's not good, especially if you are the one who needs to deal with that. Because what do you do then? Restart. Is that a solution? No. It's a quick fix. But the solution would be to solve this problem on the InfluxDB side itself, which is super tricky. So imagine you have 150 engineers, and we calculated from those 100,000 queries that we do that 0.0017% are actually dangerous queries like this. So somebody messing up something. But that is 4,000 potential outages per month. And I won't be that guy clicking the button again, starting up. It makes no sense. And it also makes no sense to switch right away to a different database engine, because this is providing us so much value. It's providing us the graphite endpoint, the clustering maybe. It's very good at compression. But definitely, being compatible with graphite is a huge plus in that area, at least. So we needed a fix, and we needed to make it happen somehow. So that's why you have a circuit breaker. And the term circuit breaker is very generic. So it just stops the flow as a safety measure, whatever it is. I guess it comes from electricity. If you put your finger into a socket, maybe a circuit breaker should work. it's not far away from running something in production. So it always needs to automatically prevent system outage. And the focus is on automatically. I mean, we can prevent it, but how do we do it? Looking at every query, it's impossible. We looked at other systems that did that, and there's one very famous one. That's why I was asking about Elasticsearch in the beginning. They have something like that. And how does it look like? You have the JVM heap, so all the memory that is in there. And then there's a couple of circuit breakers. You can set a total amount of memory that is allowed to be used on your heap. So in, I guess the default is 70%. And a circuit breaker is watching over that value. And whenever something bad happens, it will just, you know, run a garbage collector, do whatever it can to bring it down again to 70%. Stop queries, stuff like that. And how does it stop queries? There's two circuit breakers that it will manage. This parent circuit breaker has two small child circuit breakers. One is for field data, and the other is for request data. Field data is everything that is, let's say, related to your data in the form you save it. So fields are the tokens in your logs, for example. These might be fields, or all the metadata that you push into Elasticsearch. And request data is everything that you need for running a request. So the aggregations, for example. And if you see it in action, it looks a bit like this. Everything's fine. Somebody does something weird. Memory usage goes up. So you can see there's not much memory remaining. Eventually, the circuit breaker flips in. And then it will be restored to the default value. And we want this for InfluxDB. And it's not only us. It was a lot of people. So you can't read this, but it was at least 43 open tickets on InfluxDB, open issues, regarding a query engine and memory usage. It was everybody that was running that was basically saying InfluxDB should fix it, and it needs to be fixed in the query engine. And we were waiting for that, and it just took too long. It is also not implemented yet. So for us, there were a couple of options. We could tolerate system outage for our metrics backend. We could enforce a list of rules on all developers and make sure that nobody breaks them, or hope that nobody breaks them. Or we could make sure that potentially dangerous queries are blocked automatically. And that would mean fixing it ourselves. And I guess everybody would have done the same. There's sometimes you need to fix things yourself and have a quick fix now. So our goals were, first of all, protecting InfluxDB from running out of memory. Second, preventing clients from stalling, because it does not make sense to send 50,000 data points to a browser, because it needs to be rendered into a dashboard, and then your JavaScript engine will stall. And you get that nice little, you know, that window when it comes down from the top saying, yeah, you want to stop that JavaScript? Yeah, this happens then. And on the other side, you also want to give the developers hints automatically on how they can improve their queries. So this is why we wrote that tool, and we found a very badass icon for it. This logo is definitely saying I'm very evil, but it's very useful. So we use, as I said, Grafana as a dashboard engine. We send some queries to Protector, which runs as a proxy between our dashboards and our database. So currently, Grafana and InfluxDB. And it will analyze those queries, and it will filter out the bad ones. And of course, this is highly, it really depends on what you define as dangerous. So there's a set of simple rules that you can enable and disable to make this happen. Yeah, but that's the whole system. So it's just a service for analyzing queries and stopping the ones from even reaching InfluxDBs that are dangerous. So that select star from blah, that would have been blocked. This is how it's implemented. There's a proxy in front that takes up the requests that should normally go to InfluxDB. Then it will parse the query. Then it will normalize it. And then it will analyze the query based on some simple rules. And the rules are very, very simple. One more thing for normalizing, what I mean with that is just you can omit terms. So saying something like select star from my series, it's the same as select star from my series where time is the whole thing, where over the whole range of your data input. And you normalize it by saying, okay, if it's not there in the query, then you fill out with the default values, and that makes parsing it a little bit easier. And this is how a rule looks like. Don't get scared. A lot of it is documentation that will be used when you run Protector and just show me the list of rules that are available. It will show you the text on the top. So this one, for example, it will block negative group by statements. What that means is you've seen before that you have group by. I need to go back. Sorry about that. In the third line, you have group by time 1 hour. But you could also, if you're nasty, you could say group by time minus 1 second. And you might say, OK, this is ridiculous. Either nobody will run it, and people run this. But also, it makes no sense. Nothing bad will happen. But it breaks the database. So that's why we have a rule for it. And all of those rules, they come from developers breaking the database. So whenever somebody breaks the database, that's a unit test for us. But we only analyzed every query that we had. When we developed Protector, we analyzed 100,000 or 1 million, I don't remember really, real queries. And we said, OK, what will we block? And since we run it in production for 5 or 6 months now, we had never a system outage. And we also never touched those rules again, because they kind of they are everything we need, at least for now. So there's a description for each rule. And there's a check. And in the check, you get a query, and you analyze which type of query that is. And it can be, for example, a select query. And if it's a select query, then it's OK. If it's not a select query, sorry, then it's OK in this case. But if it's a select query, then check the resolution. And if it's the resolution is bigger than zero, then say OK. And if not, yeah, stop it. So what is the resolution? Resolution is just a term for us that we use internally for the grouping statement. So last 24 hours with a grouping of 1 hour, that would be a resolution of 1 hour then. So the finest way to zoom in, to see one data point, would be the resolution. So if the grouping is 1 minute, the resolution is 1 minute. So what outages did we prevent with that? Easy things, drop series test. You can drop a series. It will then load all the shards into memory, remove the data points that belong to that series, and write it back again. And it's super expensive. And also, it's a loss of data. So only an admin should be able to run this. We don't drop metrics on the dashboard side. It makes no sense. We want to do this on an operations point from an operations point of view. List series count. What's wrong with that? Well, the problem is this is too unspecific. So this is a regex, and with 3 million metrics, it will do the regex matching. Very expensive. So you need to make it longer. Limiting this by 10 data points. But what is the series name? The star? Well, it makes no sense. But people run it. Select star from prod. So that would mean give me all the data points and for prod star. So that is, we calculated something like this. We calculate this on the spot. And we tell you, OK, here's some things to make this possible to avoid this. And it's written in Python. I don't want to bore you with that, but it works for us. And it was also easy to deploy. It was rapid prototyping. So that's, we just kept it this way. Why switch to something like Go? If this runs 1,000, at least 1,000 queries per second, and then it's fine for us. We can scale it up. to many instances and many processes at the same time. So the lessons learned, build simple tools yourself. Don't be a monkey, be an engineer. So if you need a tool, build it. Don't wait for others to do it. It's better to have a working solution now than to have a perfect solution later. I think that's simple, obvious, and keep it simple. So we don't want to extend it that much. The only thing that we have for future is maybe we don't want to extend it to other databases anymore because we keep this specific to InfluxDB. If we want another thing for Prometheus or for Druid, then we do it again, but for this service, because they are just too different. But we can monitor the monitoring. So we track the queries that we run, and all the queries that we don't query for, so all the metrics that we don't show in a dashboard, well, they are useless. We can remove them, and we can bring down the number of metrics again. So this is also what Google does. If you see that you don't query your data, then it's no sense of tracking it. And if you want an idea for your next tool, then InfluxDB has clustering support, but it will be closed source. And so what is an alternative to clustering is having, let's say, a consistent hashing ring for each of your nodes and routing the traffic to the nodes that have the data, to query the data, and also to write the data. That's just an idea for another service that would be very, very useful. Here's two links, one to the GitHub project, one to the tech blog. How much time is left? None? More than 5 minutes? OK. I can show you real quick a demo. And you know how demos work, right? But I was thinking maybe I can at least start it here. So let's say you want to run Protector now. You could either install it with Python. You can say pip install Protector. But you can also run it in a Docker container. So if you say docker run Trivago Protector, then this is what you get. It's already started. I have the image locally, so this is why it's not downloading it. But here's the list of rules that we have, preventing deletes, preventing drops. Series ends with dot is usually a sign for a query that was not finished. Short series names are blocked. Too many data points are blocked. Group bias negative. That's what that was the one that I showed you. Negative group bias statement. And old data, because it needs to load old data from the disk. Yeah, and now it's running in the foreground. So I could actually go into the container now. First of all, let me check the name, the container ID. So I'm now inside the container. And let's say I run this query now. So select star from my awesome series foo. And then Protector will say, not a good idea because you did not specify a limit. So you can now say, OK, I want to improve that metric and say, as it is telling me, setting a group by statement, setting a limit, and things like that. And this is just a plain output, and you can see it then on your Grafana dashboard. And react on it. OK, that's it from my side. Any questions? Doesn't look like it. OK, if there's no other questions, then thanks.